What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do?
As history rolls on, we come up to a little bit more current history, but the same question asked of Compassion staff and leaders across the world: what are you gonna do? I became president back in 1993. I followed on the heels of a remarkable president. Wally Erickson was a real president. To this day, I kind of feel when I sit at my desk like a little boy in his daddy's pickup truck. I'm waiting for someone to walk into my office and say, "What are you doing sitting there?" Wally trained me to be president. He mentored me. And when he stepped out in 1993, I was fully trained. I knew what my role would be. My role was to keep Compassion as good as it can be, with excellence as our hallmark, and to grow it as big as it could be. And he had mentored me and exposed me to so many things that I could do that way. So we had a big banquet the first week of October in 1993, and we said goodbye to Wally and we said hello to Wes, and I became the president of Compassion. Well, it was a remarkable week that I will never forget, because I came suddenly alive. The colors of everything around me were so much more brilliant all of a sudden. Songs, hymns were roaring through my head and moving me to tears that week. Scripture that I read, that I'd read a million times, suddenly jumped out with new meaning. And by Wednesday, I was like, what has happened? How am I so spiritually alive this week? And then it dawned on me, there must be tens of thousands of people, many of them the poor, who pray for the president of Compassion. They just don't know that his name is Wes and not Wally this week. And so some sort of a mantle of blessing fell onto me that week. Well, the first week in October in Colorado is antelope hunting season. And being a hunter from Africa, I still go out there and fill my freezer with antelope meat. So I was out there that weekend. And everybody else was a better hunter than me. They'd already gotten antelope and gone home. And it was Sunday. And I was out there all alone, and it was evening, and there was nobody for 5 miles in any direction, just me and the jackrabbits and the coyotes, I suppose. And the sun started to set behind Pike's Peak, and since there was nobody around, I was singing. This was such a week. I was singing hymns and worshiping, and then finally, as the sun sank behind Pike's Peak, way off on the horizon, I just sank to my knees in the sagebrush, and I was overwhelmed at what God had done. And I was thinking, Lord, you took this very frail little boy from Africa, and you entrusted to him this great, great ministry. And as I was watching the sun go down, I thought, isn't this amazing what God has done? And I wonder what God would do in maybe the 20 years that I might be able to be president till I'm an old man and they move me on as well. And I was thinking, you know what? It could be a million children. And out of nowhere, I heard a voice so clear that I thought, there must be somebody who snuck up on me. And the voice said, "That's all?" And I looked around, I got my God, I'm looking around like, who snuck up on me out here and said that? It was just that clear. And when I realized there was nobody around, just me and the coyotes and the jackrabbits, I thought, oh my goodness, this week, that might have been God. And so I said, Lord, if that's you, I would do this for one child. That's all, a million. And then I heard a voice say the following phrase, which I don't know if I heard or it just roared through my head, but it was, well, what about all the rest of them? And it occurred to me, a million children in this hurting world is wonderful, but it's nothing. And there would always be children that we would never reach as a ministry. And there would be children in countries we could never get to as a ministry. And there would be children who hurt in ways that we're not equipped to address in this ministry. And I realized all of a sudden that God had given us a mandate for our generation, not just grow the place as big as it can grow, not just make it as good as it can be, but challenge the church, awaken God's people all across the world to the importance of children, and get them to do what we've done all these years so faithfully, believe in children and minister to children. And I sat in the sagebrush and I just wept that God would have a mission for us during our time. Well, I went back to the executive team the next week and I said, guys, I've got to tell you what happened out on the prairie. And as the team listened in our devotional time, they said, Wes, that sounds an awful lot like the voice of God to us too. And a few months later, I mentioned this to our board of directors. I shared this vision with them. Compassion is a very conservative organization, and we're not inclined to change things very quickly. I know organizations can lose their way with some great flash of vision, but these are all godly people at the table. And they said, you know what, Wes? That changes everything, doesn't it? And they sat down and they redrafted the mission statement of Compassion International to now read, in response to the Great Commission, Compassion exists as an advocate for children, to champion children all across the world. Well, that was 15 years ago, and we've been very faithful to that. All across the world, we have challenged the church to the importance of children. We've trained pastors, we've influenced seminaries, broadcasts. That's why I do Speak Up with Compassion. That's why I wrote the book Too Small to Ignore, was to try to champion the cause of children to those who should care, those who should know, those who should be doing it, to join us in this battle for children. Tell you something I've never told anyone around, but the very first copy, I'll never forget holding Too Small to Ignore in my hands and realizing I'd obeyed the voice of what are you gonna do. And so I wrote a little message to God in the front of it, and I went right out to the very place where I had heard his voice, and I buried it in the ground under a stone right there and said, Lord, this is my Bethel. I met you here. I know that you hang out here, and you asked us, what are you gonna do? Well, we've been faithful, and we've done it. Thank you.
What are you gonna do?